This virtual model is an accurate to the inch reconstruction of the working conditions in the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. It visualizes the spread of the fire minute by minute. Pauline Newman describes working in this factory as an 11-year-old girl. The Triangle Waste Company was located at Green Street and Washington Place. The day's work was supposed to end at 6 in the afternoon. But during most of the year, we youngsters worked overtime until 9 p.m. every night, except Fridays and Saturdays. No, we did not get additional pay for overtime. We were not organized, and we knew that individual protest amounted to the loss of one's job. No one in those days could afford the luxury of changing jobs. There was no unemployment insurance. There was nothing better than to look for another job, which will not be better than the one we had. Therefore, we were, due to our ignorance and poverty, helpless against the power of the exploiters. The days were long and the wages low. My starting wage was just $1.50 a week, a long week, consisting more often than not of 7 days. My job, like that of the other kids, consisted of trimming off the threads left on the shirtwaist by the operators. We were called cleaners. Hundreds of dozens of shirtwaists were carried from the machines to the children's corner and put into huge cases. When a factory inspector came to inspect the factory, he found no violation of the child labor law, because he did not see any children at work. We were all hidden in the cases and covered with shirtwaists. Clever of them, was it not? Somehow the employer seemed to have known when the inspector would come, and had time enough to arrange for our hiding place. Since our day began early, we were often hungry for sleep. I remember a song we used to sing, which began with, "I would rather sleep than eat." This song was very popular at the time. But there were conditions of work which in our ignorance we so patiently tolerated. Since it was money the Triangle Shirtwaist Company employers were after, this was an easy way to get it. If they had a conscience, it apparently did not function in that direction. As I look back to those years of actual slavery, I am quite certain that the conditions under which we worked and which existed in the factory of the Triangle Waste Company were the acme of exploitation perpetrated by humans upon defenseless men, women, and children, a sort of punishment for being poor and docile. Just as the bell announced the end of the workday, a lit match was dropped into a box of clothing scraps at the cutter's table. At least 2 tons of fabric scraps lay scattered across the factory floor. The factory floor had not been cleaned in over 2 months. The fire rapidly spread out of control, spreading from the 8th to the 9th and 10th floors. 8th floor workers escaped in time. 10th floor workers fled to the roof, and from there to the neighboring building. About 200 workers were still trapped on the 9th floor. The origin of the fire was adjacent to the only unlocked fire stair. Within 2 minutes, this fire stair was impassable. Panicked workers rushed to the only other fire exit. It was locked. A lucky few took the elevator to the ground floor. The elevator made a first trip, then a second. As the elevator descended, a human crush pushed workers into the open elevator shaft. 19 fell to their deaths and lay piled at the bottom. As workers rode the elevator, they heard just above their head the sound and vibrations of bodies falling onto the roof of the elevator cab. Fire engines arrived within 2 minutes. Firemen brought out life nets to capture falling workers. The nets broke. Workers fell with such force that they crashed through the pavement. Firemen brought out ladders. The ladders could reach no higher than the 7th floor. The rear fire escape buckled and fell from the heat of the fire. Workers were faced with death by fire or death by jumping. Eyewitness Lewis Waldman described. Crowds, I among them, looked up at the burning building, saw girl after girl appear at the reddened windows, pause for a terrified moment, and then leap to the pavement below, to land as mangled, bloody pulp. This went on for what seemed like a ghastly eternity. Occasionally, a girl who had hesitated too long was licked by pursuing flames and, screaming with clothing and hair ablaze, plunged like a living torch to the street. Anna Gullo, a survivor age 20, described how she considered jumping to her death. I thought it was no hope for me to be saved. I went to the window of Washington Place. I broke the window, and I threw a pail of water, and the flames came up higher. Then I crossed. I'd done the sign of the cross. I thought I would jump out of the window, but I couldn't. I had no courage. A few of those who died from the fall. Anna Altman, from Russia, age 16. Abraham Binovitz, from Russia, age 30. Kalman Donek, from Russia, age 24. Celia Eisenbeck, from Russia, age 17. Daisy Lopez Fitz, from Jamaica, age 26. Celia Gitlin, from Russia, age 17. Fanny Lanzna, from Russia, age 21. Lena Goldstein, from Russia, age 22. Julia Oberstein, born in the United States, age 19. Molly Gerstein, from Russia, age 17. Gassi Schiffmann, from Austria, age 18. Annie Ciminello, from Italy, age 36. Isabella Tortorelli, from Italy, age 17.
Solidarity forever, solidarity forever.